वेलकम, आई एम एडवोकेट भाग्यश्री बोस। इन टुडेज लेक्चर वी शैल डिस्कस अबाउट द टर्म पर्सन, इट्स मीनिंग एंड काइंड। द टर्म पर्सन इज डिराइव्ड फ्रॉम लैटिन वर्ड पर्सोना, विच मीन्स अ मास्क ओन बाय एन एक्टर प्लेइंग अ डिफरेंट रोल इन अ ड्रामा। इन अ मॉडर्न डेज इट हैज बीन यूज्ड इन अ सेंस ऑफ अ लिविंग पर्सन capable of having rights and duties. Now it has been used in a different sense in a different disciplines. It is in a philosophical and moral sense the term has been used to mean the rational quality of a human being. In the law it has a wide meaning. It means not only a human being but also association as well. There are legal persons who are not human beings, such as the corporations, companies, trade unions, institutions like universities, hospital are the example of artificial personality recognized by law in a modern age. Hence, the person is an important category of a concept in a legal thing. Particularly, the business and corporate laws have extensively used the concept of a person for the protection as well as imposing the liabilities. Then we shall see the definition of a person. The term person is derived from Latin word persona. Savigny has defined person as the subject or a bearer of a right. But Holland has criticized this definition on the ground that person are not subject to right alone but also duties. He says the right not only reside in but is also available against the person. There are a person of incidence as well as inherence. Salmond's definition seemed to be more correct than the earlier definitions. In the world of Salmond, so far as legal theory is concerned, a person is any being whom the law regards as capable of rights and duties. Any being that is capable is a person, whether a human being or not. Or no being that is not capable is a person, even though he be a man. Salmond further explained the term, the extension of the conception of a personality beyond the class of a human being is one of the most noteworthy achievement of the legal imaginations. Then we shall see the person can be classified into the two categories. First of all, natural person. And second important classification of a person is a legal or artificial or a juristic person. There are some natural person who do not enjoy the status of a legal person and vice versa. Law of a status. Law of a status is the law concerning the natural, the domestic and the extra domestic status of a man in a civilized society. The law of extra domestic status is the law that is concerned with the matters and relations apart from those concerning the family. Thus, the department of a law of a status deal with the status of a person such as a lunatics, aliens, deceased person, lower animals, etc. There are a person who do not enjoy the status of a legal personality, but the society has some duties towards them. Those are as follows. First of all, legal status, we shall see the legal status of a unborn person. A child in a mother's womb is by a legal fiction regarded as already born. If he is born alive, he will have a legal status. Though law normally takes the cognizance of the living human being, yet the law makes an exception in case of an infant in a mother's womb. Under English law, a child in the womb of the mother is treated as in existence and the property can be vested in its name. Article 906 of the French Civil Code permit the transfer of a property in favor of an unborn person. But according to the Mohammedan law, a gift to a person not in existence is a void. A child in a mother's womb of the mother's womb is considered to be a person both under the law of crimes and law of torts. Under section 13 of a transfer of a property act, property can be transferred for the benefit of an unborn person by way of a trust. Similarly, section 114 of the Indian Succession Act 1925 provide for the creation of a prior interest before the unborn person may be made the owner of the property, corporal or incorporeal. But no property will be deemed to be vested in unborn person unless and until he is born alive. In a Hindu law also, a child in the womb of the mother is deemed to be existent for a certain purpose. Under Mitakshara law, such a child has an interest in a co-personary property. Though there is no Indian case of this point, but it is expected that a liberal view would be taken on this line and child would be getting the right to sue. In Africans' case, it was held that a child can succeed in tort after it is born on account of a deformity caused by pre-injury to his mother. India as well as in England, under the law of tort, an infant cannot maintain an action for injuries sustained while in a womb. However, in England, damages can be recovered under the Fatal Accident Act 1846 for the benefit of the posthumous child. In a short, it can be concluded that an unborn person is endowed with the legal personality for a certain purposes. Then we shall see the status of a legal status of a dead person. Dead man. Dead man is not a legal person. As soon as man dies, he ceases to have a legal personality. Dead man cannot remain a bearer of rights and duties. It is said that they have laid down the rights and duties with their death. Actio personalis moritor cum persona action. It means that action dies with the death of the man. With the death, personality comes to an end. A dead man ceases to have any legal right or a bond by legal duty. Yet law to some extent recognize and take account of the desire or intention of the deceased person. Law ensure a decent burial, its respect the wishes of the deceased person regarding the disposal of his property, protect the reputation, and in some cases continues pending action instituted by or against a person who is now deceased. As far as a dead man's body is concerned, criminal law secure a decent burial to all a dead man. Section 297 of the Indian Penal Code also provide the punishment for committing crime which amount to indignity to any human corpus. The criminal law provide that any imputation against a deceased person, if it harms the reputation of that person, if living, is intended to hurt the feeling of the family or the near relative, shall offence of a defamation under section 499 of a Indian Penal Code. The Supreme Court, in the case of Ashray Adhikar Abhiyan versus Union of India, has held that even a homeless person who found dead on the road have a right to a decent burial or a cremation as per his religious faith. In English law as well as in Muslim law, the violation of a grave is a criminal offense. As regard the reputation of a dead man, it is to some extent protected by the criminal law. Under Roman law, any insult to the body of the deceased person at a timing of funeral gave the deceased heir a right to sue for the injury, as it is treated as an insult to the heir. Under the law of France, the relative of the defamed deceased can successfully sue for damages if they can prove that some injury is suited for the defamation. Thus, it is not the right and the hence the personality of the deceased that the law recognize and protect. It is a right and interest of a living descendants that is to be protected. So for trust is a concern, English law provides the rule that permanent trust for the maintenance of the dead man's tomb is illegal and void, and property cannot be tied up for this purpose. The rule has been laid down in the leading case of Williams versus Williams, where it was said that a corpus is the property of no one. It cannot be disposed of by will or by other instrument. It was further held that in this case, even temporary trusts are neither valid nor enforceable. The fulfillment is lawful and not obligatory. It is held in Mithai Khan versus Vedha Leve that worship at the tomb of a person is a charitable and religious purpose among the Muslim, hence trust is possible. In Saraswati versus Raja Gopal, it was held that worship at the samadhi of a person except in a community in which there is a widespread practice of raising tombs and worshipping there at is not a religious or a charitable purpose according to Hindu law and would not constitute a valid trust or endowment. Regarding the property of a dead person, the law carries out the wishes of the deceased. Example, a will made by him regarding the disposal of his property. This is done to protect the interest of those who are living and who would get the benefit under the will. The subject is to rule against the perpetuity as well as of the testamentary succession. Indian Transfer of Property Act Section 14 incorporate the rule regarding the perpetuity which forbid the transfer of a property for an indefinite time, thereby making it alienable. Section 14 of a Transfer of Property Act restrains the power of creating future interest by providing in the rule against the perpetuity that such an interest must arise within a certain limits. The rule of a perpetuity looks to the date at which the contingent interest will vest. If it vests at all and hold it to be void perpetuity if this does, debt is too remote. Then we shall see the legal status of a lower animals. Law does not recognize the beast or lower animals as a person because they are merely the things and have no natural or legal rights. Salman regard them mere object of a legal right and duties but never subject of them. Animals are not capable of having rights and duties and hence they are not a legal person. Which has the ancient law regarding this? However, in the ancient time, animals were regarded as having legal rights and being bound by the legal duties. Under the ancient Jewish code, if an ox, goat, a man or a woman resulting in his or her death, then the ox was to be stoned and its flesh was not to be eaten. There are many examples in ancient Hebrew codes where cock, bulls, dogs and even the trunk of a tree which had fallen on a human being and killed him were tried to homicide. There are similar instances in India as well. In a number of cases found that animals were sued in a court in ancient India. There is a popular story about the Mughal Emperor Jahangir in which the bullock was presented before the emperor. However, these instances are merely historical interest and have no relevant in a modern time. In a modern law, does not recognize animal as a bearer of right and duties. Law is made for a human being and all things including animal are for men. No animal can be the owner of the property from a person to animal. Animals are merely the object of a transfer and a kind of a property which are owned and possessed by the person. Of course, for the wrong done by animals, the master is held liable. This duty or a liability of a master arises due to public policy and public expediency. The liability of the master is a strict and not a vicarious liability. The animal could be said to have a legal personality only if the liability of the master is considered vicarious. In a certain cases, the law assumes the liability of a master for an animal as a direct, while in other cases, liability is not direct. Thus, for keeping animals that are not a dangerous nature, the master is not liable for the damage it may do unless he knows that it was dangerous. The knowledge of a defendant must be shown as to the propensity to do the act in a question. However, if the animal is of a ferocious nature, the master is responsible for the wrong if the shows negligent in handling it. The owner of the animal of this class is also responsible for their trespass and consequent damage. If a man scatters cattle, sheep or poultry stray into the neighbor's land or a garden and do such a damage as might ordinarily be expected to be done by the things of that sort, the owner is liable to his nature for the consequences. A charitable trust can be created for the maintenance of the stray cattle, broken horse and other animals. Such a trust is created with a view to promote the public welfare and advancement of a religion. However, if the charitable trust is created only for the benefit of a single horse or a dog, it cannot be regarded as a public charitable for the instance. Charitable trust. Two kinds of a person are recognized by law, and those are a natural person and legal person. Legal person are also known as the artificial person, juristic person, or a fictitious person. According to Holland, a natural person is such a human being as regarded by law as a capable of rights and duties. In the language of Roman laws, as having a status, according to another writer, natural persons are a living human being recognized as a person by the state. The first requisite of a normal human being is that he must be recognized as a possessing of a sufficient status to enable him to possess the right and duties. A slave in a Roman law did not possess a personality sufficient to sustain a legal rights and duties. In spite of that, he existed in a law because he could not make the contract with the which under certain circumstances were binding on his master. Certain natural right possessed by him could have a legal consequences if he was manumitted. Likewise, in Roman law, an exile or a captive imprisoned by enemy forfeited his right. However, if he was pardoned or free, his personality returned to him. In the case of English law, if a person become an outlaw, he lost his personality and thereby become incapable of having rights and duties. The second requisite of a normal human being is that he must be born alive. Moreover, he must possess essential human characteristics. Legal person are a real or a imaginary being to whom personality is attributed by law by way of a fiction where it does not exist in fact. Juristic person are also defined as those things, mass of a property, group of human being or an institution upon whom the law has conferred a legal status and who are in eye of the law capable of having right and duties as a natural person. Law attributes by legal fiction a personality of some real things. A fictitious thing is that which does not exist in fact but which is deemed to exist in the eye of the law. There are two essentials of a legal person, and there are the corpus and the animus. Corpus in the body into which the law infuses the animus will be intention of a fictitious personality. The animus is the personality or a will of a person. There is a double fiction in a juristic person. By one fiction, the juristic person is created or made an entity. By the second fiction, it is clothed with the will of a living being. Juristic person come into existence when there is existence, a thing, a mass of property, a institution, or a group of a person. A legal person has a real existence, but its personality is a fictitious. Personification is essential for all legal personalities, and personification does not create a personality. Personification is a mere metaphor. It is used merely because it simplifies the thought and expression. A firm, a jury, a bench of judges, or a public meeting is not concerned as having the legal personality. The animus is lacking in their cases. Following are the difference between the natural person and legal person. A natural person is a human being and is a real and living person. He has characteristic of the power of a thought, speech, and choice. Unborn, dead man, and lower animals are not considered as a natural person. The layman does not recognize idiot, company, corporation, idol, etc. as persons. He is also a legal person and accordingly perform their functions. Natural person can live for a limited period, that is, he cannot live more than 100 years. Normally, legal person is being regal, is being real or imaginary, whom the law regards as a capable of a rights and duty. Legal persons are also termed as a fictitious, juristic, artificial or a moral. In the law, idiots, dead man's, unborn person, corporation, companies, idols, etc. are treated as a legal person. The legal person perform their functions through the natural persons only. There are different varieties of the legal person. For example, corporations, companies, universities, presidents, societies, municipalities, gram panchayat, etc. Legal person can live more than 100 years. For example, the post of American president is a corporation which has created some 300 years ago and still is continuing. East India Company was established in 16th century in London and now still is in existence. A legal personality is a fictitious attribution of a personality by law, a sort of a personification of a law. Legal person being artificial creation of a law can be as many kind as the law devises. Contingent jurisdiction recognize three kinds of a legal personality, namely the group of or the series of a man usually called as a corporation, then the institution like a hospital, libraries, etc. And third, funds or a estate like the estate or a, of the deceased person. In this way, in today's lecture, we discussed about person, its kinds and characteristics of the natural person as well as the legal person. Thank you very much.